years ago, it was my pleasure to meet Ben Parra through the Institute of St. Ange Company, where he was doing associated work. Ben Parra is executive director of the Healy International Relief Foundation, which he joined in February 2014. He previously served as the executive director of the Community Health Development Fund, an organization which provided financing services for the building and expansion of community clinics within the United States. He was formerly the CFO at the Community First Fund, leading community development, financial institute, and held several leadership positions extending international operations for USA companies. He has lived and traveled extensively in Latin America, Europe, and Africa. He serves on the International Advisory Board of the Elizabeth Town College and is a board member of SACA Development Corporation, an affordable housing and economic development organization and founding member of the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce of Central Pennsylvania. He's here today to speak to us regarding Ebola and the works that are occurring with the Healy Foundation over in Sierra Leone. It's my privilege and honor to introduce you to Ben Parra.
And it's about a little bit smaller than West Virginia, population about the size of the metropolitan area of Philadelphia, Canada, and Delaware. And it still remains one of the poorest countries in the world. He picked Sierra Leone Nation because after the war, it was named the worst country on earth. The Healy Foundation started basically establishing a home for children through Ebola victims, basically orphans during the war, and then also worked with women at risk or I guess they're called slave wives, really called it. We built up a village for homes for amputees, and most recently rebuilt a hospital that was once called the Jewel of West Africa, which was destroyed totally by the war. And now it's been operating for about 2 years, very successfully, and considered one of the best hospitals in the country. Other current projects that we're working on, we were asked to see if we can help rebuild their National Health Organization, which was a private faith-based organization that was also destroyed in the war. It's about 40 clinics. And then also we're investing to build a pharmaceutical company. We're looking into that. So. And obviously because of Ebola, we're concentrating on that as well. We hope that with all of this, I'm having problems here with this. Okay. We hope with our efforts, we hope to reduce the disparities of healthcare. Well, most of you, I guess, came to see what the situation is in Ebola. So I'll give you some background. Talk a little bit about the outbreak in West Africa and how to control the spread of the outbreak. Now, as I mentioned, now there are several strains of this virus, and despite some misinformation, there's no risk of transmitting Ebola from people who have been exposed to the virus but have not shown any symptoms. However, it is very contagious. Ebola spreads through the direct contact with blood fluids. A cough from a sick person could infect someone who has been sprayed with that virus. After symptoms developed, the virus could also be present in the patient's skin, underlying how to get these viruses. It can also survive for a few hours on dry surface, and it can survive for several days in tunnels and other collections of body fluids. However, simple chlorine can kill the virus. Ebola was discovered in 1976 and once thought to originate in gorillas. Since the human outbreak began after people ate gorilla meat. Now, however, scientists believe that bats are the natural carrier for Ebola. And that apes and humans catch from eating food that bats have drawn on or by coming in contact with surfaces covered in infected bat droppings, and then touching their eyes or mouths. The current outbreak started in a small village in Guinea, where bat hunting is very common. Now, symptoms usually begin about 8 to 10 days after the exposure of the virus, but can appear as late as 21 days after exposure. At first, we've seen much like the flu, a headache, fever, and aches and pains. Sometimes there's also a rash. Diarrhea and vomiting will follow. Then skin from your eyes or mouth. The bleeding is not usually what kills the patients. Rather, the blood vessels, even body healing fluids, cause the blood pressure to fall so low that the heart, kidney, livers, and other organs begin to fail. All this happens very rapidly in 10 days. This outbreak of Ebola started in a small region of Guinea in March 2006. It spread to some areas of Sierra Leone, a very small area of Sierra Leone, and Liberia, going viral afterwards. Today, the outbreak seems to have zoned in Liberia and Guinea, but has expanded, continues to expand rapidly in Sierra Leone. And again, the outbreak, the deadliest Ebola outbreak since 1976 when it was first discovered. Well, let's talk a little bit about the factors that could have helped this spread of Ebola. First of all, it's in nations with poor limited health infrastructure. In Sierra Leone alone, there's about one doctor for every 550,000 people, and about one healthcare worker for every 5,000. In addition, this region had no experience with Ebola. The initial outbreaks were in Central Africa, not And then we add to this the few healthcare professionals that they had their multiple health threats, like malaria, yellow fever, and HIV/AIDS. Another challenge is the frequent travel against across the borders. Many of the families who live and the tribes live on both sides of the border, and they cross just as simply feel a creek or a river across the border. Compounding that is limited cooperation between the neighboring governments, basically because of historical differences, wars, and language, especially because of the history of regional conflicts. Liberia was a supporter of the rebels during the Civil War in Sierra Leone that lasted about 11 years. And finally, the major challenge has been some local customs, especially the bureaucrats, which basically, as part of their burial rituals, the people are expected to not only wash the bodies, dress, and kiss the bodies of the deceased before burying them. Now, why haven't we been able to control the spread in that region? Basically because of this disparity in healthcare. These are just some examples of how originally the Ebola patients were being treated. These are hospitals, by the way. Meanwhile, with early detection and aggressive medical treatments, survivors can mostly survive, patients can mostly survive outside of the hospital. The people who passed away basically got to the outside West Africa kind of way. Now, what has been the response of the affected countries? According to the WHO, the best way to respond to Ebola is by educating populations on how Ebola is contracted and how it spreads. to avoid it. Another way is to develop proper hygiene and sanitation practices. By washing hands and not touching persons who have been contracted to the government. They're encouraging to identify basically the populations and the people with the disease and to try to trace all the contacts of these persons have had. In addition, to provide all the medical staff, all the healthcare workers and emergency teams with proper protective and personal protective equipment, which is lacking, which was lacking and still lacking. And to isolate all patients and of course to address and support care, if possible, with hydration and aggressive IV fluids. And lastly, is to develop safe area rituals that are in line with their local customs and provide the deepening with their local customs. Now, what is the Healy International Relief Foundation? Well, it establishes what we call the Healy Ebola Lifesaver Project, in which we work on educating people. We educate the communities on the Ebola outbreak. We train volunteers who help instruct community leaders on how to handle suspected Ebola patients. And we provide teaching materials and also posters, pamphlets, and flyers to spread it within the communities. We've also set up washing stations and community centers, markets, and gathering places, and distributed hand sanitizers, barring the other disinfectants in these isolated communities. Here's some of the posters, and these are, gels, disinfectant gels, antibacterial gels, training, medical equipment that we send over there, medical supplies. And lastly, what we've been doing, we've been providing financial support and food to families that have been affected by the virus. Now, how is the Healy International Relief Foundation coming? Basically, to pass donations from individuals, foundations, churches, in-kind donation from individuals, the GAIN, which is a global aid international network, which is a part of the Crusade of Christ mission, mission relief services, and even passports and corporate donations. We have collaborations with the Engineers Without Borders, Rotary clubs, churches, grants from USAID, private foundations, and volunteers. We say that 100% of the donations go to the people of Sierra Leone, and that's basically because the Healy Trust funds 50% of the total. Looking ahead, what can we do to make sure that Ebola doesn't spread here in the United States? I think the CDC, NIH, World Health Organizations have all agreed that we should continue to focus on containing Ebola in this area. And to extend possible move towards eliminating disparities in the healthcare and healthcare infrastructure in the development world. And basically to prepare for future outbreaks, because there will be future outbreaks of other diseases. So basically to support the global health. If you'd like to learn more about the foundation and what we're doing, I encourage you to visit our website, visit our Facebook, and also I think on each of your tables and outside of the building.